Thank you. Thank you. Well, have a nice day. For us, the day started quite well. Well, as you know, today the college has focused its work on the preparations for the European Council that is happening, as you know, on Thursday and Friday. And here are the main topics discussed today. First, on Brexit, the Commission's chief negotiator, Michel Barnier, debriefed the College of Commissioners on the state of play of talks with the United Kingdom. Technical level discussions with the United Kingdom continued late into the night last night and are ongoing as we speak now. Talks have been constructive, but there still remains a number of significant issues to resolve. Michel Barnier will update COREPER and the European Parliament's Brexit Steering Group on the state of play of the discussions later today. And now on MFF. The College was also debriefed by Commissioner Oettinger on the state of play of the negotiations on the European Union's next long-term budget following the discussions at Tuesday's General Affairs Council and in preparation of tomorrow's European Council meeting. The Commissioner reminded his colleagues that Europe needs a fair, balanced and modern long-term EU budget for the period 2021-2027, which is fit for the challenges of today and tomorrow. An agreement on that budget needs to be reached by the end of the year in order to guarantee the swift start of the next generation of program. The Commission continues working hand in hand with the European Parliament and the Member States in the Council towards a timely agreement. And now about Turkey. The College also addressed recent developments with Turkey after the launching of the unilateral military action offensive in northeast Syria in regard of its drilling activities of Cyprus. High Representative Vice President Mrs. Mogherini debriefed the College on the decisions taken by EU foreign ministers on Monday. The decisions refer to the halting of arms exports to Turkey in light of its Syrian operation. EU foreign ministers also agreed on a framework regime of restrictive measures targeting natural and legal persons responsible for or involved in the illegal drilling activity of hydrocarbons in the Eastern Mediterranean be put in place. And now about enlargement. The College touched upon the topic of enlargement following the General Affairs Council yesterday. EU leaders are expected to address these points at the European Council. And now presentation of the fourth annual report of the Independent European Fiscal Board. The chair of the Independent European Fiscal Board, Professor Nils Tigesen, also attended the College meeting today and presented a draft of the board's annual report. So these were the items of our College today. And now, with your permission, I would like to jump in migration. Well, dear friends, do you remember how I was right here on this podium in May 2015? I have to confess, five years later, that I was in a very uncomfortable situation. Because, as I have repeatedly said, I was the lucky one to be entrusted with a very important portfolio, both for migration and security, that became maybe one of the most important political ones in the years to follow. So I was here explaining what we would do to address the challenges of the emerging migration and refugee crisis. How we would strengthen our operations, first of all, in order to save lives, how we would send staff on the ground to support, to help member states under pressure, how we would increase financial resources, how we would relocate the most vulnerable, and how we would strengthen our borders. But most importantly, how to convince member states to cooperate in a spirit of trust in order to address this unprecedented phenomenon of that time. Almost 5 years later, when we look back, we see that we have done exactly that. Hotspots have been established as an operational model to quickly and efficiently respond in locations under pressure. More than 2,300 officers are deployed from the European Borders and Coast Guard, the European Asylum Support Office, and Europol combined at land and at sea in member states under pressure. Over 11 billion euros in the European Union's internal funding has been dedicated to migration and borders management. Almost 35,000 people have been relocated within the European Union from Italy and Greece, and on top of that, more than 1,100 people have been relocated since summer 2018 under voluntary relocations. Almost 63,000 refugees have been effectively resettled to the European Union, and member states have pledged another 30,000 resettlements for next year. An up-and-running European Borders and Coast Guard agency is being reformed as we speak to have a standing corps of 10,000 operational staff. Collectively, we have made the European Union better equipped to deal with current and future migration challenges. Along the way, we have increasingly come to realize that this work is not only limited to what we do within our own borders. The 21st century will be remembered as the era of human mobility. At that time we are here, more than 450 million people around the world are seeking for a better life somewhere, either as refugees or migrants. So it has become a global issue, and the global community should be mobilized and be sensitized in order to address this phenomenon collectively. This is a global challenge that we must manage with our partners. This is why in much of the work that we have accomplished these past years, political, operational, and financial, the internal and external dimensions were more interlinked than ever before. Whether this has been our cooperation with Turkey and the Middle East, our African partners, or our support to the Syrian crisis. This has never been just about money or financial support. This has been about addressing root causes, reducing irregular and dangerous journeys, and directly helping vulnerable migrants and refugees on the ground. In Turkey, we have supported almost 1.7 million refugees on a daily basis. The EU Trust Fund for Africa has offered basic support to over 5 million vulnerable people through 210 projects in 26 countries. And the European Union's Regional Trust Fund for Syria has delivered over 75 projects worth more than 1.6 billion, focused on areas including education, livelihoods, health, and socio-economic support. And these, my dear friends, are facts. These are actions that have a tangible impact on individual lives as well as on our societies. But I do not wish you to get me wrong. I do not want to present the ideal image. This is not a moment to be self-congratulatory, victorious, or complacent. Yes, when we look at the big, at the larger picture, the situation is much better and irregular arrivals to Europe are at a record low. But we also need to zoom in our neighborhood and inside the European Union. What we see in the Eastern Mediterranean, the increased arrivals in Greece, as well as the latest armed hostilities in the northeast of Syria, gives cause for concern. It shows we must be ready always and better prepared, because we don't know what the future is holding for us. The dire situation of migrants stranded in Libya is not acceptable. Morocco, a strategic partner on the Western Mediterranean route, can count on our full support. Also at home, we still need to get our house fully in order. Important progress has been made on the asylum reform package that we have proposed, and I hope this can be completed soon, because it is the only way to structurally and fairly address the challenges in our asylum system. We have made much progress on solidarity to manage migration within the European Union over the past 5 years. The number of voluntary relocations since July 2018 and the declaration discussed in Malta are steps in the right direction. We therefore need to build on these positive results and create a migration and asylum system that works for all. In addition, I also hope that we can return to a Schengen area without internal border controls soon. We have paved the way for this through the proposed reform of the Schengen Borders Code, strengthened external borders, and the option of alternative measures such as increased police checks and cross-border cooperation. This is where we stand today. This is the honest story, which you can all see for yourselves in today's reports. It is a story that it is not yet finished. And believe me, it will take time and big efforts. But it's also a story that cannot be unwritten either. What we have achieved and accomplished over the past 5 years cannot be undone. Our union today is better equipped, better prepared to face the future when it comes to migration challenges. Because here we have to be honest too. The phenomenon of migration will be with us for some time to come. The question will never be how to stop it, but how to better manage it. Thank you very much for your attention.